morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Simply Sarah Show. My name is Sarah Tuck, and I will be your host for today. Today, we have an author joining us, and his name is Jerrimiah Stonecastle. And we will be talking to him about his books that he has written and something about his life. But before we get started, don't forget to share, like, and subscribe, and also leave your comments after the show. Good morning. How are you doing this morning, Mr. Stonecastle?
I'm doing well, Ms. Tuck. Thank you for having me on your show.
Well, I'm glad to have you on the show. Glad that you could join us today. And we're excited to hear about your writing skills and what you're doing today. So can you tell us a little bit about you? I know that you are retired and from the NYPD, but can you tell us a little bit something about you and where you live?
I live in South Florida, Boca Raton. I relocated here some 18 years ago from New York, and it was a year after 9/11. As a matter of fact, I arrived in Florida on the anniversary of 9/11. I am retired from NYPD, but I did continue in a law enforcement type field, working with the Palm Beach County school system as a guardian ever since the mass shooting in Stoneman Douglas. You're aware that the schools now have armed people inside the schools. So that's what I'm doing until I'm ready to retire again in a few years.
Okay. And what started you out to writing?
Well, actually, it was basically a fluke. I was doing security for a private synagogue in New York when I ran into a U.S. attorney who I used to do several narcotics cases with. And her husband worked for HarperCollins as a publisher. And I had tried to get a book of poems published once, but at that time, he felt the market wasn't profitable enough for them to invest in it. So I never thought of anything else about writing until I ran into his wife at the synagogue that I was protecting. And she said that her husband was wondering how come I hadn't written a book. And I said, a book about what? And she was like, a book about all the operations and exploits that I did as an undercover. So I needed to get a second opinion. So I asked some of the people that I worked with, and one of my best friends who was part of my backup team, he said, you don't realize all the things that you did as far as like changing the law, federal laws regarding street buys and all the things that I did to make the department look good, because people were really, really complaining about the way the drugs were ravaging the Black community in Harlem. And basically, we just took us a couple of years, but we wound up cleaning it up. Now you can walk down Harlem safe, don't have to worry about drug addicts snacking your pocketbook.
Well, that's good.
So I did try to write a book the traditional way, you know, where you go and send out your manuscript to 100 agents and publishing houses. And I finally did get one bite from a publisher and a couple of agents. But at the time, I was a single parent raising two kids, so I couldn't finished the book. It took me 10 years to finish the book. So once I got it finished, there was no more publishers or people interested except for one person. And I think I told you his name was Peter Miller. He's part of, he's the owner and CEO of Global Lions. And at that time, he wasn't interested, but he was interested in me as an author. And he said that he wanted to watch me and see how my writing developed over time. So that's where I'm at right now.
Oh, okay. And I know you were saying something about you wasn't waiting around, and you didn't realize that in 2008 about the Indian Revolution occurring. So what is that?
Right. I didn't realize that in 2008, a lot of the authors got tired of the same thing that everybody had to go through. Like, you had to go through this thing of begging publishers to look at your work, getting all these rejections, you know, and maybe you get picked up, maybe you don't. Some people will try to get published for years and then they give up. So basically, we decided that we were going to self-publish our own works. Since we do most of the work anyway, when you're a new author and these traditional publishers pick you up, they're going to, first of all, take 80% of the profits and give you 20%. Then they're going to have you go and do all of these book signings, do basically your marketing and promotion. They'll pay for editorial services. They'll pay for the design and stuff like that. But you got to do 95% of the other work. You got to build up your following and all that stuff. So we said, why are we going to do all of that for 20% when we could go on platforms like Amazon, KDP, and keep 70% of the profits for ourselves? So, and that's what they did. So once I discovered that, I said, let me see if I could publish my own book. So the first book I published was this one called Drugs to Christ. And it was basically a motivational book on how I went through alcoholism and through Christ. I kicked it because I tried everything else. AA and rehab and all of that stuff. So it didn't work, but Jesus did.
Amen. Amen. Well, I can sympathize with you on that part. You know, when I got started, you know, I didn't really know some of the different avenues and what to do. And of course, I reached out to other authors and they was able to, you know, guide me in a direction to help me out. And I do wish it was more ways that they could promote us authors without us having to pay out so much, because it's kind of hard that when you're first or kind of say like you're the new kid on the block. And then when you're the new kid on the block and your people are wanting to help you, they say get started, but yet and still you feel like that they are taking most of the profit. And if you pay them everything up front and you only sell a few books, then you realize that, you know, you get discouraged and you just say, well, you know, I'm not going to go any further because it's going to cost me more to get started than to follow through with it. So a lot of people give up. So I'm glad that, you know, you didn't give up.
And that's true. And I found out that, you know, it may sound corny, but God helps them to help themselves. And I went on YouTube and I found that there's a lot of successful authors that's willing to share the information to you to pass along to help other authors. And I got a lot of information off of YouTube. I got a lot of tips from other authors, like on Facebook and stuff, that showed me how to go into Amazon and format my manuscript without having to pay thousands of dollars, because people don't realize that just writing the book isn't the only thing that you have to do. And like you said, there's money that you have to put out, and there's other ways around it, but that's for another show. But basically, you have to write your story, but then it has to be edited, it has to be formatted, it has to fit the guidelines for the printers. You have to know how to create a cover or pay someone to do it. And it gets a little expensive out there, because some people, you can get a cover done someplace for $10. You can get a cover paid for $1,000, but you get what you pay for. So like you said, we wish that it could be easier, but you're gonna have to put in some work, like marketing. That's the biggest thing that I spend money on, is marketing, because it's good to have your friends buy your books, or your family beg you for books. but you want to be able to reach worldwide. So you're going to have to invest in Amazon marketing. It's not that expensive. I might invest like maybe $100 a month, and it might reach 2,000-3,000 people that get to see your book. So imagine if 100 people bought your book, say it was $10. You made $1,000. So that's worth investing in your art.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. And like you said, when I had started publishing my books, you know, to get a cover done, like you said, they have the different prices. But when you get one that does good artist work and is reasonable, you want to try to stick with that person, you know, as long as you can. And it's good that you can, you know, reach out and to different artists in different fields to find out what you need and get it at a reasonable price. Some people charge just for editing anywhere from $150 to $500, $600, and $700. And I'm like, well, I mean, my book may not even sell, so I can't pay you $700. I mean, I'm glad that you can do that type of work at that price. I'm not downing that. So please don't get me wrong. I'm just saying that when people are first starting, they need to get with a group of people that can help them get started and not have them where they're going to be paying so much that they get discouraged and don't want to do it.
Right.
So it's good to have a good panel for that.
Right. And workaround that I found for that is that there are editing programs out there. I said, God bless new age technology. There are programs out there that will edit your book for you. Like I use Grammarly, and the free one is good too, but the subscription is even better. And I forget what it cost me. I think it's like $89 or something like that. And what it does is it shows you where the period's supposed to go, the commas, if your words are misspelling, if you're not a great speller, it'll figure out what word that you're trying to sell. Because I know that to have a manuscript done, say like one of my books, like this book, Frankenstina, they're 400 and something pages. And it would cost me, the cheapest I got for a professional editor to do it, you're talking $3,000. I don't have that kind of money. So I use Grammarly, and then I also use my friends. I have friends who are school teachers. They don't charge me anything because they basically get to read a free book while they're editing for me. So you probably could reach out to some of your friends who spend all that money on their education, you know, let them help you with your book. And they like getting credit when they see their name inside the book, edited by or whatever. Because I have one editor that I'm using now that she likes seeing her name in my books because she plans on starting an editorial service and she can use my books as reference. So it's sort of like the old barter system where you trade services. So that's just a couple of things you can do. As far as making your own cover, you can go to this site called canva.com where you can find a picture that's copyright and it has the templates on there and it makes your book look professional. I have some books that I've used it and then I've had others that I actually paid for because I couldn't find the right picture, but these people could and it's worth it. You know, some of them might be $50, $90 or something like that. So if you're on a budget, save up or you have the other option of using canva.com.
I use Grammarly as well. I was told about it and I use it. So I feel like it's great to help you out. And, you know, just like you said about, you know, a lot of people, they don't know where to go. But when they find this information out from like you and I, then it helps them so that they can go in and try to do things while they're on this budget a little bit cheaper so that they can be able to, you know, get their books out.
Right.
Yeah. So I know you were saying something about, you know, tell us a little bit about Frankenstein, how you did come up with this idea.
Actually, it's Frankenstein.
Frankenstein, okay, Frankenstein, yeah. Okay.
The female version.
Oh, okay.
I believe it was around April of 2012 when they had that mass shooting in the school in Oakland, California. It was that the guy walked into the Oakley University. It's a Christian college. And he killed 7 students and wounded a few other people. And then there was the Columbine massacre in Colorado. That happened in 1999. So I was at work and I was just thinking about what causes these kids to do these things, to like just go off. And at that time, I think America was doing this big anti-bullying campaign because people were getting bullied off on Facebook, and then these kids would take guns to school and stuff like that. So I wanted basically to write a book that showed the victim of bullying getting revenge against the people that do the bullying, in the hopes that people might, who are the type of people that bully people, would say, hey, you know what? Maybe I shouldn't do this because it might have consequences, because you don't know what this person is going through when they're not at school. You don't know what their home life is, and then all of a sudden they snap. And that's what happens with Frankenstein. This was a child that was suffering from gigantism, so she grew larger than anybody else. And the other kids would tease her for years. And her, you know, not to give away too much of the book, but she, when she was born, her mother died giving childbirth. And the father resented the baby because he was so in love with the mother, and the mother died. And he actually gave the baby to her aunt, who raised her until her health faded and sent the child back to her when she was like 6. And because Frankenstein, as you can see, she's not gonna win beauty contest, he would make her wear a paper bag in the house. And also, she was not allowed to have celebrate her birthday. No cake, party, kids, anything like that, because it reminded him that that was the day that he lost his wife. So you're talking about 18 years of abuse, and then all of a sudden she just snaps and she starts getting back all the people that made fun of her or took advantage of her and played nasty tricks on her.
Bullying is something that is really harsh, and really it hurts a lot of people in life, you know. I mean, people, they need to be able to enjoy their life. And it's hard when somebody is always picking on you, mm-hmm. you know. So, you know, it's just a hard, harsh way of having to live through life when you know that people are doing that to you. But we're going to continue here in a few minutes. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.
Okay. Finesse down Western Road, hey, next. Might go down to G-O-D, yeah, wait. I go hard on Southside G, yeah, wait.
I make sure that Northside E. Welcome back, and we're going to be continuing with Mr. Stonecastle and talking about his books. So you can finish.
Okay, I was going to mention, you know, I hate to get into politics, but it seems like since that person that we had just got out of the White House was in office, he epitomized bullying. I mean, he bullied his staff, he bullied families of the veteran soldiers and stuff. And he just basically looked like he undermined it, everything that we were trying to do with the anti-bullying policy. So people don't realize how bad bullying is until what happened on January 6th. That was just the culmination because nobody stepped in to stop this bully for what he was doing in the White House. And that's about the extent of my politics. But I'll tell you one thing that's good about number 45 is that he's given us a lot of material to write.
So true. moving right along. How many books in the series, and when is the next book in installment?
Okay, there are four books in the series. Frankenstein was the first one that launched on Halloween of 2018. And Frankenstein Reborn launched on the Halloween of 2019. There are two more books. The next one is April. It's called April. That's Frankenstein's best friend. And that one is going to be released next year on April Fool's Day. And then the fourth installment, which is Frankenstein the Memoirs, is going to be released in Halloween of 22.
Oh, okay. Well, we'll be looking for that. And where can they find your books?
Okay, all my books are online. You can get them at Amazon, booksellers, Toledo, Apple Books, Google Play, Barnes and Nobles, all the major online booksellers. And you can get them in paperback, ebook, and audiobook. And I just discovered audiobooks this year, because I don't know if you know anything about the prices, the way audiobooks used to be, to hire these actors to do your books. It was out of my budget. Now, thanks to Jeff Bezos, and I tell you, I give him a lot of credit for what he's done for independent authors. But once he bought Audible, now you can have your audiobook, your book changed to an audiobook, and you can either pay the actors directly, and they have a rate. They'll charge anywhere from $50 to $200 per production hour, which is very reasonable. Or you could do a royalty split. And that means that Audible gets 60% of the royalty, and you and your actors split the 40%. Or you could do a variation. And I've done a variation where we split the royalty for 20%. And then I'll give them like a tip, maybe $100, $200 tip, depending on how good they've done the book. And I tell you, some of them are really, really phenomenal, some of that. Then you're going to get some that are, no. After you hear the audition, you don't want to have them do it.
I understand, because I'm having pre-order books done, and I'm running into some problems because I didn't know that you couldn't voice it all at once, you know, have them record it and then send it all in at once. It has to be in chapters. Right. So with having to go back and tell that person, look, this isn't right, I'm going to have it in each chapter. Well, I felt like they knew what I needed because they've been doing this a while and I haven't. So I ran into a few issues which have slowed my process down of having mine done, but hopefully I will have them out eventually.
Okay, now that's interesting, because when I go through ACX and I submit my book, there's a part in there where they have you list the chapters of your book, and you have to put it in a certain format. I'm talking about just writing the title. Initially, it's very easy. Chapter one, the name, chapter two. And I'll have like the 20 chapters, and that's it. And then the narrator, they know how to put it into each section. It's already, I can't see what they do on the outside, but judging from what you just told me, they must know that they're supposed to eat. Once they see those checks, those are sections, they know how to narrate in there. So maybe you might want to have either take your book through Audible, or continue using this person. But so far, I haven't had any issues with the audiobooks. They'll kick it back if audio determines that these people are using a program, like a computer-generated voice. Nah, they don't want that. They'll kick the book back that way. Or if at the start of the chapter, there's not a space in between, then they'll send it back. But once you get somebody that knows what they're doing, it goes through the first time.
Right. Well, see, I had had someone outside of Audible to do it. So that's the reason why they was kicking back, because it was a lot of things that they wasn't doing. But then I actually have ran up on a lady. She knows what she's doing. So that's the reason why I said, hopefully they should be out here pretty soon to where I can have them published and outgoing where people can listen to them. I'm hoping to change all the books over like that. Go ahead.
Let me tell you, as far as profit that I've seen, my audiobooks are selling a lot faster than my print.
And I have been told that as well. And I didn't only try it for just that reason. I tried it because a lot of people they're not in the habit, rather, of reading. A lot of people's on this fast pace. So if they can just push a button and listen to it while they're working or driving or whatever, then maybe, you know, they'll come on reading the books.
Right.
So I did it for that. And of course, a lot of people have trouble reading. So with just listening, you can hear everything that you need to hear and make your opinion for the reviews later. Right. So that was a lot of the reasons why I was doing it as well. And I even had people to ask me, said, well, why don't you do your book in Audible so that we can, you know, be able to listen to it? And I'm like, good idea. And so I started out doing my first small children's book out of that. Right. But like I said, we've had some issues and it's still not out yet. So hopefully we'll be able to correct them. But I did want to go back a little bit of where you was talking about, you know, you have teachers and friends that can edit for you. Mm-hmm. And I do thank God for my friend that helps me edit. And she just tells me, she says, I want to bless you. And so I'm like, okay, and I want to bless you. So I sent her a donation. I said, well, here's a donation. At least it's not much, but here's something you can, you know, do. And that's how you're being blessed. When somebody bless you and you bless them back, your blessings continue. Mm-hmm. So I thank God for that. Yeah. And, you know, if you do know of somebody that can help you, a school teacher or some nice friend or somebody that's going to school that's in a field close to that or whatever, or, you know, knowledgeable, then ask them to help you. Because when you first get started, you don't need to get discouraged. Mm-hmm. You want to be able to keep yourself in the, you know, mode and mood that I can do this. I can do this, because you're going to get discouraged along the way, because I did myself. But I'm like, God gave this to me and I know I can do it. So I had to keep pushing and opening doors that kept closing in my faces to say, so that I could reach that goal. Go ahead.
What you said about that, about having other people do things for you. I formed this company 4 years ago, but I've been basically just writing. But one of the goals that I plan to do with Stonecastle Publishing is that I would eventually like to have people come to me with their book ideas, and I would basically write and publish the book for them. I have a couple of friends that have asked me to do their books, but it's just, unfortunately, I can't stop my program right now. I have certain books scheduled that I have to do. And a lot of people think that you could just write a book like that. No, it's not. I mean, just doing the outline sometimes will take me 3-4 months. So, but that's something that I would like to do to people that they have a story in them, but they don't have the skills to do it or the time to do it. So that's down the road though.
So for those people, what kind of advice would you give, you know, them, other than what you've already said?
You know, I think if you have a love for writing like I do, like it's really not about the money, you know. I just like people reading my book and saying, hey, that was a good book. If you really, really want to write, the first thing you need to do is go on YouTube, just put in author advice, how to write my first book, and you'll get all the free tips that you need. Then just get your computer, start learning how to outline the story first, because you don't want to be writing a story and then be bouncing all over the place. You want to have a roadmap from the beginning of the book to the end of the book. And then go ahead and take your time and write the story and have people that you could say, hey, just read this part. What do you think? You know, what's your take? And don't get an attitude. You know, I stopped when people would send me their books and say, well, what do you think? If you can't take honest criticism, don't ask nobody to review your work, okay? Because I've had some friends that didn't want to believe me when I told them that this is a problem, so they wouldn't pay money for reviewers to tell them the same thing that I told them for free, okay? And let me tell you, even professional writers like Stephen King, there's some stuff that he's written that is garbage. Okay, you wonder, was he on drugs when he wrote it? Okay, so don't let anybody tell you that your stuff isn't good, but we all get better with time, okay? Because my first book wasn't that great either.
Well, I will say that, you know, I'm still growing in writing. Even though God blessed me with the gift, you know, I'm not where I feel like I need to be, even though a lot of people love my work, you know, and what I'm doing, but I just want to even do more. So you can always, you know, increase, I feel like, your skills of writing. And that's what I'm looking forward to doing as I go along and increasing in everything, but, you know, especially my writing and where I can be able to help others. And, you know, not only just help and guide them in the way to be able to write stuff that people will enjoy reading. You know, that's the main thing you want to do, is be able to catch those people's attention to where they'll want to come back and get another book and read another book and, you know, continue with your work. So I think that's very important.
Right.
Can we expect a new book out of you anyway soon?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I'm finishing up this book, and it's called Mr. Death. It's called Good Morning, Mr. Death. I'm sorry I met you. And it's dedicated to the 348,000 people who died from COVID. But the book has nothing to do with COVID. It's basically a book about a young man who followed his older brother to rob these drug dealers, and he wound up getting killed. And the angel of death takes hold of him and shows him from the beginning of time to the present how death works. And it's sort of like a religious spiritual book, and it gives you a different look or perspective about death. Like everybody they don't think about it until it almost happens, or they know someone else that dies. And I'm almost finished. I hope to finish it today and publish it in 2 days.
Good. That would be great. And I know some of us would be, you know, glad to know that it's out so that we could get it. Mm-hmm. Well, we would like to thank you for joining us today. And do you have any last words that you would like to say before we go?
No, all I can say is that for you new authors, we've all been there, and just stick with it. It's your passion. Don't give up. Keep writing. They say write every day if you want to get better. And that's what I do. I write every day. There is no such thing as writer's block.
Well, we thank you for that. And we thank you for coming on. And once again, we thank each and every one of you for watching us. And if you want to come on the show, please feel free to email me at tuckproductions@yahoo.com or even leave me a comment, even about today's show or any other show, and I'll be more than glad to get back with you. And I hope that you enjoyed it and learned something from it. And if you have any questions, I'll be leaving his email, Mr. Jerrimiah Stonecastle's email, as well as mine at the end of the show. So if you need to reach out to any one of us, please feel free to do so. So once again, stay safe. And until we meet again, sincerely, Sarah Tuck. Finesse down Western Road, hey, next. Might go down to G-O-D, yeah, wait. I go hard on Southside G, yeah, wait. I make sure that Northside E.
Somebody needs to know that in the midst of your adversities, in the midst of your circumstances, there in the midst, he'll never leave you or forsake you.
I see my brothers hurting, I see my sisters crying, things ain't working out, but Lord knows I'm trying. So many disappointments, so many hearts are broken. Lord, I need some answers, I need some doors to open. See, my money's low and my bills are high. I've been going through, sometimes I just want to cry. Nobody's reaching out, nobody's hearing me. It seems like nobody cares about what is dear to me.
Oh, tell somebody you love, you love. Grab somebody and hug them. Tell somebody you care.
Tell somebody
you know you're there. Oh, God knows your struggle.
God knows.
He's there in your trouble. Forsake you, you serve a God who love you. Tell somebody you love him. Grab somebody and hug
him.
Tell somebody you care.
Let him know.
Let him know you're there.
God knows.
God knows your struggle.
God knows.
He's there in your prayer. He'll never leave or forsake you. You serve a God who loves you.
I'm trying to keep a smile in the midst of trouble. Why is life so tough, man? Why do I have to struggle? If you're a Christian, tell me, are you listening? What are you doing to show it? Hey, does anyone know it? Will you help me out? Will you lend a hand? Will you hear me out? Or can you just understand? You see, I'm tired of fighting, like my mind is rattled. Lord, I give it to you, because this ain't my battle.
Tell somebody you love them. Grab somebody and hug them. Tell somebody you care.
You care.
Let them know you're there.
God
knows your struggle.
He's there.
He's there in your trouble. He'll never leave or forsake you. He's serve a God who loves
tell
you.
Tell somebody.
Tell somebody you love.
Hug somebody.
Grab somebody and hug
tell
them.
Somebody.
Tell somebody you care.
Imagine all the pain that you felt when you were giving us love and we were giving you death. And I can see the teardrops falling like raindrops, and they can't stop for this ill spot. Heaven is the main spot. You show me love, and that's why I trust ya. You paved the way and I just wanna touch ya. I feel like I'm falling too fast. I can't see the light, how long will it last? I'm about to lose my mind when these thoughts go away. The devil sneaks in, but I gotta still pray anyway. Lord, I'm depending on you, it's okay. I know you're gonna help me make it.